One of the largest randomized trials on artificial sweeteners just dropped. It lasted 1 year, and they recruited almost 400 people. 341 adults and 38 children, all overweight or obese, were recruited and started the trial. For the adults, which were the bulk of the participants, the trial had two phases. An initial two-month weight loss phase, where everybody went on a low-calorie diet, and then a 10-month weight maintenance phase. So they were expected to lose weight initially and then try to maintain that weight loss. That initial phase did work. During those initial 2 months, they lost an average of 10 kilos. So that initial weight loss phase was the same for everyone. Then during the weight maintenance phase, the 10 months that followed, the participants were split randomly into two groups. Everybody moderated added sugars, refined carbohydrates. They were supposed to keep it under 10% of calories. And then on top of that, one of the groups replaced as much sugar as possible with sweeteners or sweetness enhancers. This includes all kinds of sweeteners: aspartame, acesulfame, potassium, saccharin, erythritol, sorbitol, xylitol, etc. So they're looking at all sweeteners combined, right? They're not differentiating specific type of sweetener. This is important about the design. And the other group, the control group, was not allowed to eat anything with artificial sweeteners. And basically they were looking at, over those 10 months, how did these two groups do in terms of holding on to the weight loss, to keeping that weight off? So it's comparing sweeteners to sugar. There's no water group, which sometimes in trials there is. We'll come back to this. They confirmed that the participants were compliant, that they were doing as told, with two methods. One was food records. Participants were asked to keep food records for 4-day intervals. They had a second method. They could measure biomarkers of artificial sweeteners in the urine, and they confirmed that those were significantly higher in the group allowed to eat sweeteners than the group not allowed. Among the adults, the consumption of sugar-rich products came down by about 100 grams, 107 grams a day more in the sweetener group than the sugar group, and added sugar itself by 12 grams more. That was mainly due to reduction of foods like beverages, milk, so sweetened milk, sugar, honey, jam, and candy. That was all for the adults. In the children, the differences in consumption between the two groups did not reach statistical significance, possibly because the number of children is much lower, so there's less statistical power, or possibly because the children were less compliant. Not entirely surprising, but that's the result. And importantly, there was no difference in physical activity between the groups. So the main difference is diet. Okay, so what happened to weight loss? They did see a benefit in the sweetener group. They kept an extra 1.6 kilos, which is about 3 or 4 pounds off by the end of the year compared to the sugar group. And then looking at groups of people according to compliance, big difference there. In the most compliant group, the result is about twice as good. So an extra 3.7 kilos kept off on the sweeteners compared to the sugar. So that 1.6 kilos main overall average result is probably an underestimate of the potential of switching from sugar to sweeteners for two reasons. One is that it depends on compliance. The second is that, remember, these folks were not on a standard Western diet. All of them were reducing their sugar to under 10%, right? So if you took somebody on a typical American diet and switched all the sugars to sweeteners, you'd probably see a bigger benefit. Hip circumference was also significantly lower on sweeteners than on sugar. And then a number of other metrics were lower at the 6-month mark on the sweeteners, but by the 1 year mark were no longer significantly lower. That included BMI, cholesterol, both total and LDL, and non-HDL cholesterol. So why did they lose significance? Same issues we've talked about. Number of people is lower, so you have less power, or maybe the compliance goes down with time, which is common to see in trials. Now, there's a caveat to this trial. There's actually a few, but one of them is a lot of dropouts. So 40% of the participants that started dropped out before the end of the trial, did not complete. That's because the trial took place during COVID, the pandemic, so logistics were a nightmare. But yeah, when you have a lot of dropouts, it creates concerns because it can bias the results. All of these results so far are for the adults. In the children, there was no significant difference in body weight or related metrics between the two groups, sweeteners and sugar. Same likely explanations, much lower number of people, and the compliance, as we've talked about, they weren't really achieving a significant difference in terms of sugar intake. Now, what is more interesting and novel is that they looked at the microbiome changes after 1 year on these two diets. And changes in microbiome have been reported before, but in much smaller trials, usually much shorter, and the results are inconsistent. Some trials indicate a change in microbiome on sweeteners, some don't. That's not particularly surprising. If there is a change in microbiome, the microbiome changes with almost everything we eat. The question is, are the changes beneficial? Are they healthier, less healthy, or neutral. So in this trial, they did look at the microbiome pretty extensively, and the species of bacteria that produce short-chain fatty acids, those types of species were increased in the sweetener group and also methane-producing bacteria. So based on that, the authors suggest that the microbiome shift seems beneficial overall. Why? Because in general, short-chain fatty acids are linked to positive outcomes. Things like increased energy expenditure, increased satiety. And so the authors suggest that maybe this is why they're better at keeping the weight off, is because they're favoring these bacteria that produce these short-chain fatty acids. Is that a high-confidence result? No, I would say it's a pretty moderate confidence result. That's a guesstimate, almost. Just based on some features, it might be beneficial overall, but we don't really know. I think with microbiome, there's a huge question mark. In general, our understanding of microbiome is pretty rudimentary still and mostly question marks. At the end of the day, a change in microbiome is not an actual endpoint of health. What we want to know is your risk of disease, heart attacks, cancer, strokes, diabetes. So I think it's really interesting that they tried to answer this question. It's the first time in a trial this large that has been looked at, but I think it's still largely unknown. Another thing they also reported were side effects, and those were more common on the sweeteners, mainly GI symptoms. So gut pain, cramps, loose stool, gas, things like that. The methane producing bugs could account for that. Also, some of the sweeteners are sugar alcohols like sorbitol, mannitol. Those in some people can have that effect. The last thing they measured was a number of other metabolic markers, things like insulin, glucose, blood pressure, liver fat, and there was no significant difference in any of those metrics between the two groups. This is relevant because there's a lot of questions about the effect of sweeteners on glucose metabolism. Do they raise your glucose? Do they cause insulin resistance? Do they cause liver fat to accumulate? In fact, just this week, there were some headlines about another study that's not a randomized trial, but that's suggesting a link between sweeteners and increased liver fat. And a lot of people ask me about it. We've seen for many years that sweeteners are linked to all kinds of metabolic issues like overweight, heart disease, and diabetes. But we have to remember that people who are overweight tend to go for the artificial sweeteners more often because they're trying to lose weight. So it creates this association between the sweeteners and the diseases that come as a result of the overweight. But the sweeteners might just be an innocent bystander and not the cause of those problems. So this is where randomized trials such as the one that just came out that we're talking about are so crucial, especially longer durations, a year or more, because things like liver fat can be seen in a couple of months going up or down. And so if in trials we see that in randomized trials, then that points to actually the sweeteners causing it. If we don't see it, it suggests that it's this spurious association, this innocent bystander effect in observational studies, but that the sweeteners are not causing liver fat to increase. So it's interesting and somewhat reassuring that we don't see an increase in liver fat in this trial, but I think it's still TBD. Okay, quick word on funding. The study was not funded by any food industry, but some of the authors had previous ties to some food companies like consulting or previous funds, things like that, previous grants that they got. I'm giving you this information so you can weigh it however you see appropriate. I'll tell you how I look at funding. I don't grade a study higher or lower based on funding. What I want to see are two things. How is the study done? Methodology. Is it rigorous? Is it well done? What question did it ask? Did it answer that question convincingly? And number two, reproducibility. Do we see the same thing over and over across different trials done by different people, different institutions, blah, blah, right? So the reproducibility takes care of this issue of the funding and the bias and all these concerns. And the weight loss results, as we said, are not even that novel. We've seen them many times before. And that the microbiome results are interesting, but I'd say somewhat preliminary. We want to see them repeated regardless of funding on other studies so we can be sure. Last question that a lot of people asked actually on social media and the reaction to this study was, okay, well, this is kind of gaming the system. You're comparing sweeteners to sugar. Of course, the sweeteners are going to look better. Yeah, but that's kind of what the sweeteners are for, right? The whole point of these products, of the diet soda and stuff like that, is to replace the regular product. So comparing these products to sugar versions to regular soda is absolutely essential. That's, I would say that's the main question we have to answer. Now, is it also interesting to compare diet soda to water? Absolutely, because you want to know, are they just better than sugar, which is important, or are they completely harmless that we can drink diet soda or water and it's a wash? So there's two levels to this. Just at the level of weight loss, we know that the artificially sweetened drinks like diet soda are very effective. In fact, in randomized trials, they routinely beat water for weight loss, which is kind of mind-blowing for people who hear it for the first time. But we see this over and over. We even see it in meta-analyses. People who go to diet soda lose more weight than people who swap the regular soda with water. How can that be? Because of secondary behaviors, right? Probably because the diet soda satiates that sweet tooth and you don't have to go eat something sweet right after, whereas the water doesn't scratch that itch and you're probably going to go eat something else. And so overall calories probably explain this. So for weight loss alone, the diet soda seems to be a very good tool for people who are overweight and who consume a lot of soda and they swap it with diet soda. Now, nobody's saying that if you don't drink any soda, like I don't consume regular soda or diet soda, nobody's saying you have to stop drinking water and go drink diet soda. Nobody's saying that because there are legitimate uncertainties about the long-term effect of consuming diet soda, especially in large amounts. After 10 years, 20 years, could there be some detriment? Sure, that's absolutely possible. So the bottom line is we have a lot of evidence that the sweeteners are better than sugar. The diet soda is better than the regular soda. If you're someone who consumes a lot of soda and you can't simply go to water, you have tried it, you can't do it, and you find it doable to transition to a diet soda, absolutely do it. Evidence-based, a lot of data to back that up. Now, if you consume neither, like me, like a number of the viewers, then you're fine. You don't need to go drink diet soda. But we're not the target audience for that product, right? That product is mainly to help people who are overweight and who consume a lot of soda and who can't realistically switch just to water or tea, switch diet soda instead. And influencers will like to poo-poo sweeteners because it's trendy, because it's popular, to say that it's unnatural, it's bad for you. If they don't explain that the evidence consistently shows that sweeteners are better than sugar, diet soda is better than regular soda, then they're not giving you quality information. I actually disagree with the WHO on sweeteners. I think their official position is probably wrong. And I explained exactly what I mean and why I say that in this previous video right here. Check it out, and I'll see you in there.